Hi, y'all. I'm Charlie Daniels.
Hi, I'm Charlie Daniels Jr., and this is the Charlie Daniels Podcast, from long hair country boy to simple man, the best there's ever been. I'm extremely excited about this episode. This is something that has been a long time in the making, since back before we did our first episode. My original idea for the Charlie Daniels Podcast was for it to be co-hosted by me and Chris Wormer, who played guitar for Dad and the CDB from 1995 until 2000. He took a few years off, and then he came back in 2005, and then he stayed until Dad passed in 2020. Chris has been a friend of mine for a long time. We used to work together. I thought we had a good rapport, and I thought that would make a really great podcast, that I would bring the family side, and he would bring the on-the-road side, and I'd have the musical history stuff. And then I thought we would kind of really kind of have a really cool foundation of a show. But Chris, unfortunately, made a career change in 2021, which meant his free time was extremely limited now. So you're left with me. I had to go it alone. That's not what I had intended, but we had to make the best of it. So this is going to be another two-part interview, as we often do. But we talked for over an hour, and so this episode is going to be pretty standard. Decided that the next episode, however, is going to be kind of what I envisioned for the podcast originally. It's just going to be Chris and I talking for the most part. I mean, I'll still do the setup, and may have be a couple of other elements in there, but most of the show is going to be Chris and I. That's next time. So stick around and be sure to come back next time for the original Charlie Daniels Podcast. Okay, last time I mentioned the Grammy Museum Mississippi Sounds of Southern Rock exhibit that opened last month. Mom and I went down for the opening along with Taz DiGregorio's widow, Danielle. Dad always said Danielle, but her name's actually Danielle. Sorry, Danielle. Roger Campbell, who I've interviewed a couple of times here, the podcast, and several other members of the CDB family. It was a great night. There was a panel discussion with Roger, Widespread Panic's JoJo Herman, and former Skynyrd road manager Paul Abraham. They told a lot of stories from the road, and the exhibit was something special. Lots of memories there. I'm showing a few of the pictures that were taken that night, so you kind of see some of what the exhibit is. Stuff from, obviously the CDB, Skynyrd, other bands that kind of were on the fringes, I guess, of the Southern Rock era. But you also had, there's some Wet Willie stuff, Outlaws, Allman Brothers. But strangely enough, there was no Marshall Tucker stuff in the exhibit. Apparently, they couldn't get through to anybody in the Tucker camp, and they have talked about expanding the exhibit in the future, possibly into another section, and they might be able to have a lot more to show, and that would be great. Hopefully that part of, if they do that, hopefully that exhibit will feature some stuff from Tucker. But this could also be a good thing for the possibility of a Charlie Daniels Museum in Mount Juliet. The wheels started turning while I was down there, shall we say. But anyway, hopefully we'll have something that we can update you on the status of that before too long. Okay, once again, I've been digging through the Facebook Live videos that they were doing for the Never Look at the Empty Seats books. And our guest, Chris Wormer, was the guy who was running those Facebook Lives, at least on the road. They started doing a few of them before they did the meet and greets. So they would take a few minutes beforehand, and Chris would he would be there to run the iPhone camera doing the Facebook live streaming, you know, question and answers, and Dad would read some from his books and stuff. So anyway, I've been digging around and I found another one, and this is Chris, and you'll get actually to get to hear some of Chris's voice on this one as well. So here you go.
Two more questions, and then you've got to go to do meet and greet. But this is a simple one. Thomas Wilson, what size is your hat? Hat size.
7 3/8. 7 3/8 inside. It's got a 5-inch brim, and I think probably using about a 7-inch crown now. But the brim is five inches from here to here, and the crown's about 7. But the inside's a 7 3/8. If you were to buy one off the shelf, it would be 7 3/8.
7 3/8. And that's why I don't wear a hat, because I can't do that math that you just did off the top of your head. That's why I don't wear a hat.
I'm happy I
can't
did.
I can't do the math. And this is a good question, I think, to end on, being the week that we're heading into. How do you celebrate Thanksgiving? Deborah Sorrell asked that question.
I celebrate Thanksgiving every year with my family. We have Thanksgiving dinner. We have family. We have friends. We usually have anywhere up to maybe 25, 30 people at the house. We have just different amounts, different years. But we have a whole bunch of people. Hazel, with some help, does a lot of cooking, turkeys and hams and dressing and vegetables and all kind of stuff, and we all drink too much. But we always, before we have Thanksgiving dinner, we always gather everybody around and we all hold hands, and I say a prayer of Thanksgiving, and we usually ended up with the Lord's Prayer and everybody said it together, because that's what it's for. It's thanking God for all the good things that have happened to us.
Absolutely. I'll let you sign off here in a second, Charlie, and I was just going to say that I was told to mention that we've had a really great response to the personalized copies on the web store. And everybody, if you want to get that, go to the link below. And we have packages for autographed books, CDs with the Never Look at the Empty Seats t-shirts. So anyway, Charlie.
I want to assure everybody of one thing, too.
Yeah, absolutely.
If you get an autograph, one of these books autographed, and it comes to my office, it will be signed by me. I sign it right here. I put the name and I sign it right on this page right here. So don't worry about getting a bogus signature, because I'm really hard on people signing my names. I don't let anybody sign my name but me. So if you order from our office, I promise you that is my signature on it.
Fantastic.
Thank you.
Well, Charlie,
thank you, Chris.
We're going to go ahead and log off, but we just want to wish everybody a happy Thanksgiving.
Happy Thanksgiving. God bless.
And now a word from our sponsor, the Charlie Daniels Journey Home Project.
Only two things protect America: the grace of Almighty God and the United States military. Words of wisdom from our founder, the late Charlie Daniels. Hi, my name is David Corlew, co-founder of the Charlie Daniels Journey Home Project. From world wars, the Korean conflict, to Vietnam, the Gulf War, and as we experience the drawdown of the 20-year war against terrorism, America has continued to send the best we have into combat, defending the beliefs and the borders of our great nation. When the fighting stops, our men and women who served begin a new mission, their own journey home. The Charlie Daniels Journey Home Project offers assistance and support in the return, the rehabilitation, and the reintegration back to civilian life. We focus on education, housing, various rehabilitation programs, as well as the tragic epidemic of suicide within our own veterans community, 22 a day. Join our mission in serving those who have served us. Donate now by contacting us at the Charlie Daniels Journey Home Project.org. The Charlie Daniels Journey Home Project.org. Thank you, and God bless America.
Okay, music time. This is going to be different. This is CDB, but the star of the video is actually our guest, Chris Wormer, doing his arrangement of the William Tell Overture, which is often known as the theme to the 1930s Lone Ranger radio series and the TV series, which ran from 1949 to 57. I promise you have never heard it quite like this. Wormy rocks, and we will be talking with him shortly. But check this out from the 2005 4th of July show at the Nashville Riverfront, which is on CDB DVD Live. Okay, the song of the show is brought to you by the official CDB website store. Okay, I am sporting my CDB 50th anniversary tee, which I love. It is beautiful. It's a great looking design. And on the back, it has all of the album names listed in chronological order. And it's incredibly cool. But we also have the Drinking My Baby Goodbye 35th Anniversary Tees with a koozie, which we also produce. The Devil Went Down to Georgia Tees. This is a favorite. It's beautiful. It's got a lot of hidden design, little elements in it. So if you get the shirt, kind of look it out and see. You'll find some little tidbits. It's almost like one of those little things you have in activity books when you're a kid. Find the hidden objects, so you may want to do that. But also the Benghazi Ain't Going Away shirts, as we say every episode, Benghazi Ain't Going Away. Dad tweeted that out almost every day up until the day before he died. We're all about keeping Dad's legacy alive here, so we're going to keep that going. The Idle Strings bracelets that Angela Wheeler makes, guitar strings used on stage by the CDB, and they, you know, we sell a lot of them, so they are going to run out at some point, because at some point there will be no more used strings for the CDB. But don't forget the open turquoise cross design with red beads on it. It's beautiful. We still have Dad's books, DVDs, CDs, including the new Volunteer Jam 1, 1974, The Legend Begins. And very soon, we will have the Duets album, which has been out for about a year, but it was a Walmart exclusive. That is now, we can actually sell those on the website, so we're getting those in stock really soon, as well as the vinyl, which I've talked about here before. So the Duets album is going to be on a beautiful 2-disc vinyl set, so we'll have those within the next week or so. I'll be sure to let everybody know on social media. But we also have a CDB vinyl Christmas collection, which is available. I think it's probably like in the next few days it'll be available. We'll have it in the same time we'll have the CDs of Duets and the vinyl. But anyway, we've also got a couple of cool new designs that we're working on for Christmas. We're getting those in the pipeline now. I'm hoping to be able to share those with you very soon, maybe pre-orders. But also, as usual, by listening to the podcast, we're sharing discount codes for the CDB merchandise. We rotate the codes out, so you have to keep listening to get the codes. But you have to listen to get the code or watch the podcast, see me, see my smiling face. This month, the code is podcast10, podcast number 1010, podcast 10. Again, for those of you watching, you can see it on the screen there. We'll save you 35% on all orders at store.charliedaniels.com. So get Christmas will be here before you know it, so you know, might want to check it out. Okay, as I said earlier, Chris Wormer and I go way back, all the way to about 92 or 93. We were both working at Kicking Bird Music down on Music Row. Not only is he a great friend, he's extremely talented and forever will be part of the CDB family. Here is part one with Wormy. All right, welcome back to Twin Pine Studios, and we have a real treat here. You are going to get to see what the original Charlie Daniels podcast was going to be like. I had originally had the idea. I said, talked to this guy and said, hey, man, this would be a great thing for us to do. And unfortunately, he had a career change that threw a wrench into the plans. But anyway, but he's here. He played with Dad for off and on for 20 years, I believe. And he's here today, Chris Wormer. Good to see you, brother.
It's good to be here. Thank you. We've known each other for a long time. It's good to be here.
Oh, I know. Going back to Kicking Bird Music days.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Yeah. Since 1993.
Yeah. We worked at a music publishing company together, and then he went on the road with Dad and had to take a little time off, but came back right before the Super Bowl. You actually came back with the Super Bowl pregame show. Wasn't that your first coming back?
Yeah. We'll cover all that. That was funny. Yeah, that was the reason I came back to the band,
right?
Really, because your dad had called me. I was living in Los Angeles. This was in 2000, at the end of 2004, beginning of 2005.
Yeah.
And we'll turn to this a little bit later on. But he called and wanted to see if I wanted to come back to rejoin the band in 2005. And he said, I said, yeah, what's the schedule look like? He went, the first gig's a Super Bowl. I'm like, all right, what time do I need to be there?
Yeah.
So I'm like, and then the second show after that, we played the Super Bowl that weekend. And then the following weekend, we played Reliant, or whatever it's called, in Houston, where the Texans play for the rodeo there. And so, like, two consecutive weekends, two huge stadiums we played. And somebody asked me, all right, you're back with the band. How is it? Yeah. And I'm going, it's like playing nothing but stadiums so far. It's been awesome.
And didn't miss a beat. So, well, for those who don't really know that much about you, you grew up in Peoria?
Peoria, Illinois.
Yeah.
Yep.
And so how did you get into music?
Music was always in our family. My mom and dad were both musical. My mom was a music teacher when I was growing up. And my dad played in local bands at the time. And I was just a wee lad. And so that was always something. I mean, there are pictures of me I'll have to dig them up and show you one, but the picture's of me standing there in my diapers with my headphones on. The headphones are about, you know, the size bigger than my head, standing there listening, and I knew how to, you know, put the records on the record player and turn it on, and there are pictures of me in diapers, like, listening to music. So it was always in our household. Now, that said, my mom was a music teacher in the public school system, and there was a time where, you know, it's just kind of an unfortunate part of you know, kind of the education system sometimes is that they have to cut some programs, and they ended up cutting the music program. So she had to get certified to teach classroom, but she was a music teacher and a great vocalist and piano player. And my dad was playing clubs. And then when they had me, it was kind of one of those things where he actually gave that up after a few years to, you know, and then he ended up getting a job and retiring from Caterpillar. But so music was always around, always around. And to that point, though, when I first started showing an interest in playing guitar, I actually played saxophone first in grade school because it was time to you know, join a band. I was like in fifth grade or whatever it was. And I was like, well, my dad played the saxophone, so I'll play the saxophone. So I played that, you know, from about fifth grade till about eighth grade. But then I started thinking, you know, I'm not going to get many girls playing saxophone. But my friend had an acoustic guitar, and I thought, this is the coolest thing in the world. And so I started playing guitar, but my parents, by nature of being musical, they always, and my dad was connected in the local kind of music scene, and they did this with my brother as well, but they made sure, they sought out like the best kind of teachers for me to really kind of nurture that. And I ended up studying bluegrass for about 2 years with a great teacher.
I did not know that.
With an amazing teacher named Bob Applegate. And then he had kind of, after a couple years, he had just said, I've taken you as far as I can take you, and turned me on to another teacher who was teaching traditional jazz, a guy named Bill Barker. And this is all in Peoria. And so I started playing, you know, traditional jazz, which actually helped me in my transition and my jump to wanting to, you know, I was going through high school, I was playing in bands and all that stuff, but my ultimate goal was going to Berklee College of Music or Juilliard or something, and I ultimately ended up settling on Berklee College of Music. And so my parents were real instrumental, no pun intended or pun intended, in that for me, and my brother as well. So my brother's in the industry as well. Yeah. So that's kind of how I started. So I started out bluegrass and then played traditional jazz. And then in high school, I discovered, you know, Eddie Van Halen and all that stuff. Right. And so I ended up playing rock music in a rock band before I headed to Berklee.
Yeah. So how did you get into the CDB? How did that?
That's a great story. It's actually, I moved to Nashville in 1992, graduated Berklee in 1991 in December, and my degree was in music production and engineering, and I wasn't originally coming to Nashville. I wanted to go to Los Angeles and be a session musician. I wanted to be a session guitar player. At the 11th hour, this was probably, I graduated in December of 91 from Berklee. My high school band instructor ran into my mom and dad at a store somewhere, and this was probably in July of or August of that year. And they said, he said, hey, what's Chris up to? And they said, he's almost done with Berklee. And he's like, what's he going to do? And they said, he wants to head to Los Angeles. And he said, what's he want to do? He wants to be a session player. And he said, there's a guy that went to high school here, the same high school that I went to about 15 years before, that is in Nashville. And he's a session musician, highly regarded, highly respected. And maybe he can reach out to him.
Yeah.
And I thought, Nashville, you know, and it really wasn't on my radar, honestly. And so I got the guy's number, and it was a guy named Steve Gibson. And Steve Gibson is a highly respected name in Nashville.
Very much.
So anyway, Steve said, you know, you're at Berklee and you finish in December. Yeah, come on down to Nashville and I'll take you around, show you around and do all that stuff. And I thought, okay. And I came down and Steve took me to, he was doing maybe a Sawyer Brown record at Scruggs Studio. So I came down from Berklee, and now all of a sudden I'm in Nashville, and I didn't originally intend on landing here. Steve was taking me around to all the studios, his sessions that day, and showed me Nashville Music Row. Yeah. And I remember going back to Boston, I went, I'm going to Nashville. I'm going to Nashville. So I got here in January of 92. Now, I can say this, for how did I get into the CDB? all roads, all steps led directly and dropped me right on your dad's doorstep.
Right.
It one job led right into the next, into the next, into the next. It led me to, yeah, to the CDB.
Because we met at Kicking Bird Music.
We did.
And you were working there, and I started working there. And then it wasn't too long before you were hitting the road. You were also working with Noah Gordon.
That's right. That's correct. Yeah. And so when I first got into town, I took a job just to get in with a company as an intern for a publishing company. Now, I was in the tape room making tape copies and lyric, yep, copies, and you know, oh, the, yeah, whole, you, oh, know, yeah, that whole routine with getting songs recorded and cut in Nashville.
Oh, yeah.
So I was working for free doing, yep, that. There was a producer named Chuck Howard, mm-hmm, that had a co-publishing deal with that publishing company, but he was a music producer. He needed a production assistant, so after 2 months of being an intern, he's, you know, he
now
said,
production,
yeah, I need a production assistant, which basically kind of helped him manage his day-to-day. Yep. But what it thrust me into, I was like, great. One, it paid me. Two, yeah, it thrust me into the music industry. It became an education. And again, keep in mind, this all leads to your dad. Mm-hmm. And so I was now booking his sessions. I was booking in the musicians for these sessions. I was handling the album budgets. I became his liaison between him and the record label, between, right, he and the record label. And I was learning the publishing industry, all that stuff. And as, mm-hmm, you mentioned, one of the artists he was producing was a guy named Noah Gordon. Noah was about my age. And one of the things when I was an assistant there, they knew I played guitar. They had a little project studio kind of in our office. Mm-hmm. And so it wasn't uncommon for some of the songwriters to go, hey, man, you want to come play guitar on this track? And I was like, yep, sure do. But one of them was Noah. And Noah, yeah, and I kind of developed a rapport. And then after about 8 months of doing that, 9 months, Chuck came to me and he just went, because Chuck would throw me on some of his projects too. He'd, yeah, have me play guitar and nothing major, but I mean, he would have me doing this stuff. And he said, man, you're a player. You don't, mm-hmm, you don't need to be booking my session, right, doing all this stuff. And he said, I'll tell you what, I'm producing Noah. You and Noah have a great rapport. You know, I'm going to produce Noah's record and I want you to play in his band. And you go on tour with him, do the whole thing. That way, you know, Chuck and I still got to work together, yeah, because he was going to be our producer. And then I thought, this is amazing. So Noah was signed to a deal. And then the key element there, so keep in mind, publishing company internship, working for Chuck, playing for Noah. And then the Noah thing lasted for about 6 to 8 months.
Yeah.
We had a couple attempts at making, we made the album twice. We recorded it.
Oh, really?
It.
I didn't even,
yeah,
know that.
Yeah, we did. We recorded it, and then they didn't like some of the tracks. We went and recorded the whole album again, and then there was some kind of some red tape, and Chuck was let go off the project. The record label let Noah go. They didn't let him go, but they said, we're going to have to shelve the project for about a year, which meant Noah had to cut the band loose. So I was just, so keep in mind, this is 1993, mm-hmm, and I'm just in Nashville. You know, my wife and I have Julia, you know, we've got, yep, a small child. We just decided to buy a house. And so I thought, I'm working with Chuck, I got a salary, now I'm playing with Noah, this is great. And I had a salary, I'm playing with Noah, this is awesome.
And then all of a sudden,
it was gone. Yep. And here's kind of where it comes in with meeting you as well, is that Noah was going to have to let the band go. So he called me and said, hey, I got to give you guys some news today, but whatever you hear today, just know that you're taken care of. And it was kind of cryptic. I don't know what that means, but okay, whatever. So we end up going to the meeting. Noah said, the record label is going to make us let, you know, has to, you know, take a pause on the record for about a year or whatever. I got to let you guys go. And I thought, oh no. And then afterwards I was thinking, I wonder what he has for me. As soon as we got done with that meeting, he said, call David Corlew. Now, David Corlew, for those who may or may not know, has been with your dad since the early 70s.
Oh, yeah.
And was your dad's manager. He was Noah's manager.
Yeah.
Okay? So I called David, and David had a music publishing company, but he didn't have an office on Music Row. So he had songwriters, but they were always having to go write with the co-publishers at their office. You know what I mean? He didn't have a presence on Music Row. And so David said, I know you're losing your gig with Noah, but he said, I talked to Chuck, and Chuck said you have really good publishing, you know, company experience and good music business experience. And he said, I'd like you to find an office on Music Row
And so we can set up, a presence on Music Row for the publishing company, and I want you to manage day-to-day operations down there. And I thought, that's got a paycheck. That's awesome. Yeah. But it really was a blessing because I went from literally having these jobs, I'm thinking, this is great. This is all happening pretty quick, to getting ready to close on a house and then going, hey, you're out of the gig.
Yeah.
And so internship, Chuck, Noah, David Corlew. So now, and where I met you, we're at Kicking Bird Music, which is a music publishing company, and you came to work at the company, and we were there, I think, 8 to 9 months, maybe almost a year. And then in October of 1994, this is how I came to be in the CDB. Now, let me preface that by saying, when we were playing with Noah, I had met your dad because we're in the studio here, but your dad had offered the opportunity for us to rehearse out at the studio. You know, David was our manager with Noah. And so your dad, you know, we came out, and I was like, when Charlie Daniels says, hey, come out to the studio and rehearse out here, and we went, let's go do that. Let's do that thing. Yeah. Charlie said, you come out here and hang with me. And so anyway, when we were out here in the studio, we were getting ready to go on tour and do some shows with Noah. And your dad just said, you know, they had amps, there were guitars and amps, drum kits everywhere in the studio. And your dad said, any of these amps that you want to take out on the road with you. Again, he didn't really even know me. Yeah. He just knew that I played with Noah.
Yeah.
And he said, anything you want, take out on the road with you. That's fine. And I went, I'll do that. Yes, that sounds awesome. And here was the coolest thing about that. When we were doing those dates, because there are a couple of them laying around the studio here, but there were road cases that had the Charlie Daniels logo on it. And at, you know, Mount Juliet, Tennessee. And I was like, they were road cases. And I thought, I'm going to, whether there's an amp in that thing or not, I'm just going to take the road case out. So there was nothing, nothing quite like rolling into a gig with Noah at this club somewhere and me running in with my Charlie Daniels, you know, amps kind of going, yeah, this is real. This is, you know, see that right there, Charlie Daniels? Yeah, he let me use this. So your dad was very supportive of Noah, but that's how I met your dad. So now flash forward to October of 94.
Bruce Brown.
What's that? Yeah. And so I get a call from David, and he said Bruce Brown has broken his collarbone on tour. Now, Bruce had been in the band maybe 5 years. Yeah, at this time. Yeah, so he had been in the band about 5 years. But anyway, they were on tour, and he broke his collarbone. David said, would you be able to go sub for him? And I thought...
Sorry.
Oh, yeah. No worries.
It was only Mom. Sorry. I'll call you back, Mom.
Yeah. This isn't documented or anything. Yeah. So anyway, so Bruce had broken his collarbone on the road, and, you know, David's like, do you want to go play with Charlie? I'm like, yeah, gee, let me think.
Yeah.
and so it was great. I said, yeah, absolutely. So now what happens is he said, you need to call the tour manager at the office, B.B. Evans. She will get you all the music you need. All the CDs, if you need that. They have a live front of house mix of the live recordings. And anything you need, you have to get ready. And I had about 2 weeks to prepare for this. And then at the end of the conversation with BB, and this is my first interaction with her, and I said, by the way, when's the rehearsal? And she just busted out laughing. And you can hear her laugh. Oh, yeah. And anybody, if you ever heard it. And I was kind of like, what did I say funny?
Yeah.
And she was like, you know, the rehearsal is going to be, I can't remember what day it was, but the first show was going to be in Charlotte, North Carolina. And so she was like, the first rehearsal is going to be like October 25th in Charlotte, North Carolina at 9 p.m. And I thought, looking at my calendar now, I'm going, that looks an awful lot like the showtime. And she's like, bingo.
So
no rehearsal. I just went in cold. Yeah.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
I don't think I knew that you just went in cold. But I mean, but you're a professional. So,
well, you know. I wasn't then. And that's questionable now. But dude, here was the thing about it though. It's like I'd never been on a tour bus because with Noah, we were doing the rental van with the U-Haul attached to the back and all that stuff. And so here I am now. I was in the shoes of where Tommy Crane once stood.
Yep. Oh yeah.
And where Bruce had been standing, and I'm now, you know, kind of filling in for Bruce. You know, Bruce wasn't going anywhere. He was once he healed, he still had the gig. It was almost like a backup running back in the NFL. Yeah. You know, I was just coming in. Bruce wasn't going to lose his starting position. Wow. I was just coming in to play while he was out. And Charlie, I'll never forget what that first show felt like. I can see it. I can feel it. It was electric. It was stunning. I'd never experienced anything like that in my life. And so I'd grown up playing. I'd played in front of people. I played in local bands growing up in high school. Yeah. Played in rock bands. We had a pretty decent following, so I knew how to play in front of people. But I'd never been in the situation where everybody in that venue was there to specifically see that band that you're in right there, to see Charlie. And it was one of those things where I remember about an hour before showtime, and I hadn't talked to your dad yet. And so, you know, I'm a bundle of nerves over there on Lady LaRue, which was our bus. And, you know, I'm just going, I can't believe this. What, you know, this is unreal. And so I thought, I wonder if I'm going to get to talk to your dad. So right at that moment, I heard on one of the walkie-talkies, the radios on our bus, it was like, Charlie would like to see Chris Wormer on his bus. And I kind of went, they went, you heard him, you know, and I thought, okay, cool. And I didn't know what I was getting ready to walk into. I thought maybe I'd walk on the bus and, like, your dad, like, this was that moment where your dad was going to say that one thing. And then, like, my whole world would spin into focus, and then it would be like, angels singing. And it was like, that's the secret of life right there.
Right.
And so I went up on the bus. I met your mom was out with him. I met your mom and sat down across, like, much like you and I are here at your dad's table on his bus. And he's like, son, I can't thank you enough for coming out and helping us out. And I'm really looking forward to this. It's going to be fun. And I'm waiting for it. And then he was kind of like, here's the moment. And he went, you have any questions? And I kind of went, no. And he's like, see you on stage, son. And I thought, oh, my gosh. And Charlie, there's no experience like getting ready to go on stage. You're 2 minutes out, let's say. You walk towards the stage, and you can feel the energy of the crowd, right? And this is my first time doing this on this level with your dad. And the house lights go down, and then the crowd starts to anticipate. Mm-hmm. And then the spotlights are going, and then the intro music starts. And then I'm getting goosebumps just talking about it. The intro music starts, and then all of a sudden, it's go time. The intro's almost over. You get up on stage, and you hit that opening chord. The lights blind you, and then the music hits, and they can see you, and you're looking at the audience, and they're all just kind of like wide-eyed looking at your dad as your dad comes running out on stage. And I remember playing that first song and just getting through it, and I'd never heard a crowd or been on the receiving end of a crowd response like that.
Yeah.
As soon as we hit that last note on the first song, and I think at the time we came out with two fiddle songs, like Drinking My Baby Goodbye, and So I Was Going to Do It Again, right? And so we normally do the first two songs of the night. We do the songs back to back. So there's no one song and then greet the crowd. We go straight from the first song into the second song, and then he greets the crowd. You know, hello, Charlotte, how you doing? And then all that stuff, right? But after the first song, we hit that last note, and the crowd erupts, and I just kind of look there, and I just... My adrenaline, I mean, I could have gone skydiving 10 times in a row and not had the adrenaline rush that I had there, because, dude, it was unbelievable.
Yeah.
But, Charlie, I had a moment during the second song, and I looked over, and there was a side spotlight hitting your dad from that side of the stage, and it was almost like time kind of stood still. It was one of those things where I kind of looked over, and I'm playing, and I saw this silhouette from your dad. He's down there. It's the typical silhouette you always see. Head cocked to the side, chin down, you know, his eyes closed, drawing that fiddle bow. And it was just, I thought, you have got to be kidding me. That's Charlie Daniels right there. Dude, I can't even put into words what that moment meant. But then we got through that first show, and we did October and November. And then that's kind of where it changed. It changed at that point.
Like I said, next episode is going to be something very special, very different. It will be part two of our interview with Chris, but since we recorded so much and the conversation just, it could have kept going on for hours, which is what I really had a feeling Chris and I could do on the podcast. So I'm going to make the next episode, it'll probably be 90-ish% is going to be just our interview. So it's going to be very similar to my original idea for the Charlie Daniels podcast. It will be great. Please check it out next time. Okay. Okay, this coming weekend is the medallion ceremony for the Country Music Hall of Fame and Museum, where former music executive Joe Galante, Keith Whitley, who died way too young, tragically, and the killer, Jerry Lee Lewis, will become members of the Hall. In thinking about things I could talk about in this episode, I decided that I would read Dad's own words from his October 16th, 2016 medallion ceremony acceptance speech. It's pretty brief. Dad always hated it when people droned on and on about themselves, so he wanted to keep it short and sweet. So here it is. The grandiose words it would require to adequately describe the sea of gratitude and the mountain of honor I'm feeling tonight simply do not exist in my vocabulary. And I'm not sure if the words to describe the emotions I'm feeling in my heart right now exist at all. When I look around me at the images of those who I have admired, respected, and emulated, whose very shoulders I stand on, and to think that I will be represented in that same manner on those same walls is a very humbling thought indeed. A plaque on these walls is not just an award or an accolade. It is a page in a history book, an unending history book, a story that will go on and on as long as talented young men and women with desire in their hearts and a fire in their belly to continue to write and perform the songs, travel the miles, and pay the dues. Many of the faces on these walls laid the foundation and established the infrastructure for those of us who would follow in their footsteps, taking their music down two-lane blacktops into the mountains and swamps to common folks whose lives their songs reflected. Through depressions and wars, they sung their tunes about lonesome freight train whistles and love gone wrong, played at the hoedowns and drinking songs, and helped America remember that no matter how dark the days of war became, there was a star-spangled banner waving somewhere. The Grand Ole Opry was the force that brought it all together, and as the first true stars like Roy Acuff and Ernest Tubb began to emerge, and their songs boomed across the Southeast and the Midwest on the airwaves of the Clear Channel Voice of 650 WSM, young men glued themselves to the radio every Saturday night and dared to dream about one day being part of this wonderful thing that was happening in Nashville, Tennessee. I know because I was one of them, and from the time I learned my first three chords, my life has been devoted to the creation and performing of my music. It's been a rewarding life and an exciting life, and I would do it all over again in the twinkling of an eye. For me to acknowledge this most distinguished recognition and not to acknowledge the fact that I would not be standing here with it not for the love of, and loyalty of my wife and son, the fact that God has granted me yet another desire of my heart, and that I have been surrounded by some of the most incredible people who have stuck it out with me and had my back through some heavy storms. It's been a great ride, gang, and we're still in the saddle. And it ain't over by a long shot. Bring it on. The acknowledgments I make tonight would not be complete without recognizing my dear friend and mentor, Bob Johnston, who brought me to Nashville in 1967. Bob passed away a few months ago, but I know if he were here, he would take great joy in this event. So with the greatest respect for the past and the greatest aspirations for the future, I humbly accept this indescribable honor, desired by so many and attained by so few. I realize just how truly blessed I am. Long live country music. God bless Music City. Thank you. That's all we have time for all things CDB, podcasts, new releases, merchandise, and much more. Go to charliedaniels.com. And be sure to subscribe wherever you get your podcasts so you know when the next episode drops. And check out the video Apple Podcasts, or you can go directly to charliedaniels.com/podcasts, and we have the video link there. And check out Charlie Daniels'
and friends, Volunteer Jam 1, 1974, The Legend Begins. CDs are at Amazon or the CDB website store or streaming wherever you stream music. And next time I'll be able to tell you about when we can have the duets and CDs and vinyl in stock and the Christmas. So we'll be able to talk about all of that then. This is Charlie Daniels Jr., and let's all make the day count. And don't forget, Benghazi, it ain't going away. Neither is Afghanistan. The troubles in Ukraine with inflation now, and now they're talking about some very, very scary stuff happening with regards to the economy. So recession, you know, Brandon can deny it, but recession, you know, it's not an imaginary word. But anyway, there you go. Let's go, Brandon.